I'm going to go to the list first and show you. Here's a quick way to see. Location planning. There are really only two considerations that you should be making when choosing your location for Milky Way. One, your foreground. Using the composition tips that I gave you in the previous video, this one, you guys can see, and right here is the link, you guys can see that actually you, blah, 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 blah. Want to see me? Use the video linked right here to go see my composition tips. Otherwise, once you've decided on a cool foreground, the other consideration is number two, and most important, honestly, light pollution. You want the darkest sky possible. And so my favorite tool is lightpollutionmap.info. Lightpollutionmap.info is fantastic for showing you pretty up-to-date blooms of light. If you're lucky enough like me to live in the West Coast, the west side of the United States, then you're sitting here working around islands of light pockets. You've got light blooms that you have to work around in little city areas that are going to cause blooms of light in your image. And so you want to make sure that your foreground and the light pollution play nice together, or if you're lucky enough, completely eradicate light pollution if at all possible. I have a video right here that you can click on right there that breaks down all my light pollution avoidance philosophies, and you can go into detail there. But one thing I want to emphasize is that depending on where you're standing near that light pollution bloom, you can mitigate it. Even if you have some light pollution in the distance, if you're further away, you pull that light pollution bloom down to the lower part of your frame, and so where it blooms up, it's not messing with the core. And check out this, you can even have fun with a light pollution bloom and it doesn't ruin your shot. So you don't always have to avoid light pollution like it's a plague, but if you can get it off of your Milky Way core, success. That's all you really need to worry about. If it's below, and let's let this get started. Yes. Okay, I am going to listen to the delay for a second to make sure that everything is working. But looking at my gear there, looking at the camera here, looking at everything below, I believe it is working perfectly. I don't have any delay anymore. That is so fantastic. However, just before this began, that box over there supplying power to that camera turned off. I had to gaffer's tape the cable into it. And I had just a little bit of tech issues. One last tech issue before we get started. But I'm listening like the audio is great. I don't have to hear myself anymore. Let's get rolling. Hey everybody, it's Milky Way Wednesday, and I'm Aaron King with Photog Adventures, and today we are going to talk about more Star Tracker gear. Maybe this piece of gear sucks, or maybe this is just the wrong one. And I brought in a friend who's going to help me out with that. So as we get started with every Milky Way Wednesday, and I say hello and hey to all of you who are joining me right now, let's bring you in. So Hudson, no delay. Jerry Thompson, hello from Utah near Dry Lake City. Great Salt Lake drying up. What up? Hi from Ontario, Canada. Oh, you are synced. That's what Kathy says. I am synced from now on. I will never not be synced. It's going to be awesome. And less than 3 hours to the Bisti Badlands. Rhonda's talking about something else that is less than 3 hours. Although my drive, no, where she lives is probably only that. I wish there was sound, said John Henry Maurice. And there is sound. And so maybe you were thinking of something else because I have sound. I heard that I have sound. In fact, I'll even listen to the delay here. Oh, yeah, totally, totally have sound. Low sound has gone away, and even in the cam chat, I have the cam chat mic working, so John, there might be an issue on your side. Ryan Luna says, hello, Jeff Gard, hey from Chicago. Man, there's so many Chicagoans here. Chicagoans, 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 Chicagoites. I think Kathy told me once what it actually technically was. Goose evening. Good evening from Phoenix, Joe Harvey says. And Kathy, what part of Chicago, Jeff? She's talking to you, Jeff, already. David says, hey, from North Carolina. And then I have sound with the ads, but not Aaron. John and Maurice, that's something on your end because the sound is coming through. At least everyone else has given me a good thumbs up that the sound is working for them. So welcome in to Milky Way Wednesday. Have any of you gone out since the beginning of the year? Has anyone had, I have clear skies finally. Has anyone been out? What kind of adventures have you been on? Hey, Earl, how's it going? SS Mold says, hey, Mark Moore here in Mission Viejo. Hey, awesome. Welcome in, Chicagoans. Okay, cool. I got it right, Chicagoans. Thank you, Kathy. So this episode that we're talking about, and I'm going in and I'm going to bring in Alyn Wallace. Hopefully I sound fine. I feel like I'm faking it well enough. I might have the vid. I might have the Omicron vid. I got the Omicold going right now. I all of a sudden started having fevers and headaches and cold ever since Monday. And I'm just in the throng of it right now, enjoying it, enjoying my time off. I'm a little stuffed up, have a huge headache, but it's not as bad as it could have been. I am vaccinated, so I'm safe from being killed by this, but so far, so good. Jeff Guard says Rogers Park, and Thomas Turner sounds great for me. Good. George just ordered the MSM and the V bracket 2 days ago. Yes, awesome. Fibs. All right, MaryBeth says something there I won't describe out loud. John Deal says, here in beautiful West Jordan. Hey, welcome, fellow Utahn. And Thomas Turner. No, not yet. Hasn't been out yet. Oh, man, get out there. Orion's going to be great all the way through March, but it's going to be fantastic to capture sooner than later as clouds and just how low it is instead of being high in the sky. When it starts getting over there to the west and setting, it's a different angle as well as just more things are being blocked by the horizon than they are right now where it's at zenith. So it's a clear, beautiful time to capture Orion. Chris Riding says, Omicold, no issue. Exactly. I just got to get through it. And Kaveh says, sound is great. Blake Fair, sound is great in Oceanside, California. Thank you, Blake. All right, awesome. I now have sound and do not know why. It slowly started. That's weird, John. I'm not sure why it wasn't working for you, JHM. But let's get started. I hope I don't look too faint and too pale. I was told today that I look pale, but at least we're here and I get to click play buttons instead of actually having to perform for you. But before we go into it, I want to talk about how this piece of gear I am most likely replacing, and you'll find out here listening to Alyn, as well as the Star Tracker. So those of you who said you pulled the trigger today, like Mark, awesome. Welcome to the Star Tracker world. When you get out there using that laser we talked about last week and then using some of the tips we told about getting a leveling base, making sure it works, using these to fine-tune them, as well as making sure you have the right latitude line, we're going to go into a little bit of tips extra from my friend Alyn Wallace today. But, okay, I have to bring up something that is a huge announcement today that I'm totally stoked about. And so I want to tell you it before we watched Alyn Wallace, before we watched that, as well as let everyone know that today, as I go through the Alyn Wallace segment of the video, we're going to go and finish it off tonight with MaryBeth, where we're going to have 13 minutes, I think, of the video from her post-processing so that you know what that course has, so you have some more information before you pull the trigger and join us. We have our live event January 22nd, which is next Saturday, and so we are going to go, and from here, MaryBeth's going to be in studio. We're going to teach image number 3 and go through the Zoom class with all the students that are part of the course and help you master star-tracked Milky Way photography through Adobe Photoshop. And so I'm going to give you a 13-minute preview of that today so you can make your decision wisely on whether you want to join us. It's just next Saturday, so get into it today so that you can get image number 1 and image number 2, start working on them. I can work with you before we get there to Saturday 22nd and then get ready for mastering it with MaryBeth's help. So here's the announcement, and I'm just going to show you my Facebook page over on Photog Adventures, and then we're going to go into this. Let me go full screen and make this a little bit fatter. Come on. Oh, you know what? I shouldn't have used that button. That is a weird button. I'm thinking about my Mac still. I'm using buttons for the Mac and zooming in nicely. Mm-hmm. Yes. And I think this one will also be zoomed in. It's not. Okay. All right. Here we go. The announcement that Alyn Wallace. Oh, I wanted to start here. What an idiot. Alyn Wallace. My nose. The cold. I haven't been around anyone, so no one else is getting sick from me, but I hate being sick. Alyn Wallace is joining me on the June. Okay. For a workshop. My head is not here tonight. Alyn Wallace is going to be a second instructor for my workshop out in Crater Lake in Oregon Coast. I have an intermediate one that happens from the 21st, I think, until some date, but starting with the advanced one only, the 27th through the July 1st, where we're using this Sky Watch Star Adventure or any star tracker that you have, That advanced Milky Way workshop out in Crater Lake has 7 slots open. And talking to Alyn today, he's going to be in the United States. And so I got him to agree to come and join us. And he's going to be my second instructor for that workshop. And so you want to hang out with Alyn Wallace, you want to learn from Alyn Wallace, and you want to go on a workshop, this is the workshop for you. If you click on the link that's in this page, it'll take you right here where you can join me in Crater Lake and Oregon Coast. We're going to spend 2 nights in Crater Lake, 3rd night in Secret Beach in Brookings, and then out to Bandon. Beautiful Milky Ways, beautiful opportunity to test your Star Watch, your Skywatch Star Adventure, or any star tracker that you have, and to join me and Alyn Wallace. It's the same price it already was, but I'm adding Alyn Wallace to this. I'm adding him to be a part of the workshop and help me teach it. So if you want to hang out with me and Alyn Wallace, this is the best opportunity. You know, in fact, I meant to put a link to this right here in the chat, but if you go to my Facebook, some of you say you don't have a Facebook, so I'm going to just copy this link, and I'm going to paste it right now in the chat. So, oh, whoa, that is a huge link. That is way big. I don't want to give you that link. I ended up having a bunch of Facebook additional features on it, and that is unnecessary. So now I'm going to kill all this other stuff, and I'm going to copy this link, the much shorter link. Double check that it works. Okay, good, even with that shortened. Boom, there's the link to join me and Alyn Wallace out in Crater Lake. Oh, I hope you'll come. That's going to be a really fun adventure having Alyn Wallace along with us. Okay, without further ado, let's get going with the segment of me and Alyn Wallace that we recorded a little earlier today during his time frame, his time zone, and making it more convenient for him. So I will not be here live. I'll be back live right after this clip. Welcome in, everybody. I have Alyn Wallace with me right now, and he is joining us from Wales, and we are talking Star Tracker Z brackets. Now, I was showing you this one, and I was showing you some of the flaws and difficulty I've had with this one. It's particularly this plate right here up front, this red one. It looks like it might be something that you can custom adjust. It appears that, okay, I adjust this with an Allen wrench. Maybe I can rotate this, because when I twist this guy onto my Star Tracker, which is a Skywatch Star Adventurer, and then it goes to its tightest point, it stops at a weird angle. I want it to stop with this angle, and it continues beyond that point, and then I get this awkward position. If only I could adjust this red bracket right here and go back straight and make this look awesome. Unfortunately, it appears that with these 4 screws right there, and I was just telling Alyn about this, and the way that they appear on the other side on the black, where they're anchored into the hard black metal, I don't think this thing rotates without taking those screws entirely out, and then what? And I just need to give it a little bit of a rotation, not a full 90 degree, or I guess that'd be 45 of it. And so I don't know about this. I think this is a useless Z bracket. And when I was looking for a Z bracket, all I looked for was something that did this. I didn't know what else to consider in my Z bracket for a Star Tracker. Well, now I got Alyn Wallace here, who not only has a lot of experience doing this and knows what he's looking for in a Z bracket, but he has actually designed a Z bracket that you can buy with all of those considerations included. And so, Alyn, I want you to show us your Z bracket, the Move Shoot Move one.
Yeah, so I had exactly the same issues as you. I was looking for a Z bracket to get a nice level base on my Star Tracker, and I couldn't find one that locked the rotation or even allowed you to rotate. And then obviously the hinges work on like friction, so you constantly have to use a tool to adjust them, which is like when you're out in the cold and you can't feel your fingers, it's just a pain in the ass. So I designed this. So before I was a full-time photographer, I was a mechanical design engineer, so it's nice to actually use my degree. So it didn't, all that money didn't go to waste. But yeah, this is my little Z bracket, which I designed, and it's been manufactured by Move Shoot Move in Hong Kong, but they have warehouses in the US, in the EU, in the UK. So shipping's not an issue. But the difference here is that first up, the hinges, let's try and get some focus.
There we go.
The hinges have nice thumb screws, so you can lock the hinges at any angle you want. And then we also have a thumb screw lock on the rotation. So You could unscrew that and this thing will rotate. So if I just put it on the move, shoot, move.
Yeah, go for it.
Probably be a better idea. And let's see what angle it stops at, because that's the issue you've been having, right?
Yeah, exactly. Mine stops at whatever angle it wants to, and it is not conducive to what I need.
Annoyingly, it stopped perfectly, but let's say it's like it stops here. You can just undo that thumb screw, get it nice and level, and lock it into place. And then you can just close these hinges. And then there's a bubble level on top, so you know you've got a nice flat base to work from. And these thumb screws, you might think, oh, that's like, can you see that? The screw gets in the way, the device.
I do think that, exactly.
But the good thing is you can pull these levers out and repositioning them without affecting the screw. And you can do the same with these ones on the side. If it's colliding with the device, you could just pull it out, reposition, and then you can turn.
You really did think of everything.
Right.
Other than those being like tiny finger controls, like it is, I had to use a player pliers last time I used your Z bracket on a client's at a workshop, and we just felt like we needed little pliers sometimes just because they're little guys. How do you feel about the size?
The one here is pretty small. The thing is, when I originally designed this thing, it was mainly for use with the move, shoot, move. So we were trying to keep in mind the portability and the lightweight sort of setup. We're in the middle of refining the design, making something that's a bit bigger and sturdier, you know, a little less fiddly, let's say. But we've got two different designs. So that's the Z bracket, which has the, you know, the two hinges. And then we also have the V bracket, which is simply one hinge, which is the one I use most of the time.
You actually tend to use your V bracket only, huh?
Yeah, I don't really need that extra hinge. It's useful for other uses, but with a Star Tracker, what I normally want is just a level base to work from, because it's really annoying having your Star Tracker or your ball head even at like a stupid angle.
Right.
And you can't look that way. You can't go that way. But the other thing I've been using it for a lot is panoramas. And when you're doing a panorama, you really have to have a nice level base to work from. So I could just level that on top and use this to create my tracked panorama of the sky.
Oh, okay. So no matter where you're standing with the tripod, no matter what angle you're at, you can just level it out and then go for your panorama left and right.
Yeah, exactly. You've got the horizon nice and level, so the panorama stitches nicely as well, which is like a huge time saver if it doesn't go well.
So when someone's considering buying a Z bracket or a V bracket, what would be some of the use cases they should consider a Z bracket for?
We've had some crazy ones. I mean, I use them sometimes to hold a microphone. Like when I'm traveling and I've got like the Rode video micro, I'll attach it to a V bracket or a Z bracket, so it's angled towards my mouth when I'm doing like live streams like this or whatever, recording some voiceovers for my YouTube videos. Somebody's been using it for doing macro photography. I'm not really sure how. Some people have been using it to hold binoculars. Using the Z bracket to hold binoculars on a tripod, and they can position the binoculars wherever they want.
Those giant heavy ones that are good for sky watching.
Yeah. And there's been some really interesting use cases.
So if someone only wanted to use it for a move, shoot, move, should they just get the V bracket instead of the Z?
Well, it depends. I mean, there's not a huge difference in them. The V bracket is like a little bit lighter, like a tiny bit lighter.
Okay.
But the Z bracket comes obviously with more flexibility and more uses because you've got the two hinges. So you can quite literally use one of these things instead of a ball head because you can pan, you can tilt.
I see.
You can reposition your camera. And a lot of people are using these for time-lapse work. So when you're on a slider, this can sort of hang the camera over the edge so that you don't have the slider in the foreground.
Oh.
Gives you extra bit of height. It's crazy the amount of uses that people have been finding for these things.
Yeah, that's interesting. So I see that you also have the Skywatch Star Adventure over there and the Move, Shoot, Move. So with the rest of this time, for those who are trying to decide whether they get a Move, Shoot, Move or get a Skywatch Star Adventure, what are some of your reasons to say one is better than the other?
Ooh, interesting. So for me, the Move, Shoot, Move is like portability, wide angle stuff. If you're doing landscape astrophotography, perfect. You know, 14 mil, 24 mil, 35 mil lenses. I'd use this up to 135 mil.
Okay.
The Samyang 135 mil, for me, that's the limit. But if you wanted to do some telephoto, deep space, deep sky astrophotography, then you got to go for this bad boy.
Oh, I see.
But it's a little bit more reliable and a little bit more sturdy. So when you're doing like tracked panoramas with big heavy gear, then maybe you want to go for the Skywatcher. But for me, the Move, Shoot, Move, it's just that portability and that lightweight. When you're hiking up a mountain, and you're sweating and you're swearing at yourself and cursing at the gods, like that extra weight that you've saved is so much worth it, man.
I was just looking at your Amazon link, and if you see the link going down below, you can also find the link in the description for his Z bracket, but I'll include in the description down below the one to the V bracket as well, so you can check out both of them. But looking at his Amazon link, you see that the others are like 3.54 in size, like inches in size, and yet theirs is only 2.60, so there's just so much less weight, so much less metal in that. When you look at something like mine, it's a massive amount of addition to your gear. And if you're going to go hiking, you're going to want to get Alyn's version of it for sure.
Hopefully we'll have a more beefy version coming out sometime this year as well.
Oh, yeah. You're adding more so higher payload, maybe even able to do longer lenses, or just still the Move, Shoot, Move is the choke point there for longer lenses. What's the purpose of a beefier one?
Just for the ease of use. I mean, these thumb screws are a little bit small, so we just want to make it a bit more user-friendly. And, just something that can take an extortionate amount of weight, because these things are really solid. Once you've tightened them down, they're really solid. But we're looking at maybe adding some sort of supporting system to the side just to be safe in sort of really windy conditions and that kind of thing.
Oh, interesting. Something like a kickstand almost.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So before I let you go, I want to ask you a couple things. I've been talking about getting polar aligned and how the easiest way to do it is with, you know, a laser. You point it in the sky. What is your method for getting polar aligned?
So the lasers are great, but obviously if there's aircraft in the skies, you've got to be really careful. Otherwise, you'll end up in prison or something. So one of the things that a lot of people don't know about, especially with the Skywatcher Star Adventure, there's a thing called a polar sight. So there's a little hole just here, little hole.
Oh, I'm one of those who didn't know about that.
Yeah, and you can use that to do rough polar alignment. So I always make sure my tripod's nice and level. Then you set the, you set the angle of elevation of your star tracker to your current latitude on planet Earth. So if you're in Colorado, which is like 40 degrees north, you'd set that to 40 degrees.
Gotcha.
And then just sort of rotate this so you're aiming north. And then just look through that little hole here. And if you can see Polaris through that hole, then you're probably going to see Polaris as soon as you look through the polar scope.
Oh.
Because a lot of people struggle with like,
right,
is that Polaris? Am I looking at the right star in the polar scope?
Like, exactly. You all of a sudden it becomes 16 bright stars inside there. Which.
But if you just start with that hole, get a nice rough polar alignment, then you're probably going to see Polaris straight away as soon as you look in the polar scope. If you've got the Star Adventurer Mini, there's like, it's almost like a gun sight. There's like two little arches on top of the device, and that makes a hole. Sadly, they don't have it on the Move, Shoot, Move, but what I tend to do is the laser holder. Let me just grab it.
Yeah, go ahead.
It's in here somewhere. Yeah. So, it does have it. Sorry.
I'm just looking mine and realized all this time I never paid attention to what that hole could be for.
Yeah, right. You just threw the instructions away, didn't you?
Well, yeah.
So, this is the holder for the laser for the Move, Shoot, Move. which attaches to the side of the device, and you'll notice that we put a, come on.
Yeah, focus. There we go.
There it is.
Oh, so there's a that hole polar. There too.
Yeah, that little one there. So you start with your polar alignment with that little hole, and then when you use the scope or whatever, the laser, it's pretty much going to be already there. You could just fine tune with your adjustments there.
That's awesome. I mean, all the times I've talked to Eric Benedetti about it and talked to others who have done this, I have never heard that about the hole on the side of my Skyway Star Adventure. And
yeah, right.
Move Should Move has one. Because that is so much easier, especially in certain locations where you can see Polaris no problem. You look through that and you know you're looking at it. And then you look in through the zoomed in version, the telescope version through this, that all of a sudden now is 16 bright stars. Yeah. It is much nicer. That is going to be gold. I hope every one of you are taking note of that right now, because Alyn just dropped a really good trick that I have no idea about.
Right. And I'm going to be sharing some videos on my YouTube channel soon about how to polar align when you can't see Polaris.
Yes, that would be key. That's a good one. Often in
so
the
I've got some,
we go there and the trees are blocking our view of the north, and so we can't see Polaris even though the sky is clear. So there's some conditions you might not expect that'll block Polaris.
Yeah. So I've got some interesting tricks for that as well. So
sweet.
Come on over to YouTube and check that out.
Yeah, if you guys haven't already subscribed to Alyn Wallace's channel, make sure you do that right now and give a big thanks for Alyn to coming on right now. So before I let you go, I'm going to ask you something that might be impossible to answer fast, but ooh, what would you say are your two top tips that you give to someone new to Star Tracker Milky Way photography?
Oh, that is a good question. Two tips for Star Trackers. Be patient and persevere, because polar alignment can cause people to rip out their own hair. But like once you've done it a few times and you start whittling down, the process becomes a lot easier. So don't worry. Like once you get over that hurdle, it becomes a lot easier. And the second would be to practice your blending of skies and foregrounds, because the foreground blurs. So you need to take another exposure for the foreground. Then you need to be able to blend those two together. So watch as many YouTube tutorials as you can about selection methods, about blending the sky and the foreground. Check out the new sky replacement tool in Photoshop as well, because that's super helpful for creating your sky masks as well. That's like, it saves so much time.
Oh, absolutely. It is the biggest thing that you have to, it's like the steepest learning curve of going into Star Tracked images, is that now you have to leave Lightroom, the ease of Lightroom, and go into Photoshop and work with layers, maybe something you've never done before, and mask, select, move things out, make things perfect, clone tool, all sorts of features that you maybe have just shrugged off in the past that now you got to become a master of.
Yeah, exactly.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Alyn, for joining me on the live stream. Everybody,
thank
go
you
thank
so much
him.
For having me.
You bet. Hit the subscribe button on Alyn Wallace's channel. You'll see a link in the description. That was kind of sudden. I thought there would be a finished sentence there, but I forgot. I cut off description before even the end shows up, so I don't need this anymore. So as we were going through that, someone mentioned and said, okay, I've got a Skywatch Star Adventurer, do I need this? I don't have an MSM, a Move, Shoot, Move, so do I still need this? Well, here's the thing, is do you need a Z bracket? Yes, absolutely need a Z bracket or V bracket. That is guaranteed. Whether you buy Alyn's and use the link down below that was on during the video, or the one that's in the chat, you'll look in the video description of YouTube, you'll see this right there. Do you need that? It's up to you. I recommend it now, especially talking to Alyn and seeing all the better features and seeing why mine here has problems. But just remember that this is the profile of your gear, and you have it pointed towards it. If you've taken off the hockey puck, as we have, then you're back even further. But if you're on the hockey puck, you still have a little bit of tilt up and your ball head's working like that. But you do still need to get your ball head where you're pointing your camera up, because you're pointing this way at your feature. And if you want to do a panorama, you want to get as level as you can. And this is okay, but look at how I've extremely pushed my ball head to its limit of how to get that parallel with the ground. And if you just have a Z bracket or V bracket, where now you can just bring up, just simply bring it up and level it out right here, now you're using your ball head and your ball head has all the features, all the capabilities of being on your tripod completely level, and you can move it around. In fact, you can even go for using your panorama head more easily here thanks to that, like Alyn was talking about. So you do need a V bracket or Z bracket of sorts. Whether you use the move, shoot, move, that's entirely up to you. So that was an amazing hangout with Alyn Wallace. Really, really love him for doing that and joining us today. In fact, I am going to open up the channel just to remind you. If I know Hangerbird said that he or she has already been an Alyn Wallace subscriber for many, many years, and so there's no problem. But if you're not a subscribed member of Alyn Wallace's channel, make sure you go over there, just Alyn Wallace. The channel itself is just Alyn Wallace name, and you can go there, join one of his subscribers, and follow him. Learn from Alyn, and if you want to join us out there on that workshop, hang out with Alyn, hang out with me, and learn it. This will be a really fun experience, since he doesn't usually come, you know, to the United States very often. So I'm stoked to have him. I'm stoked to have him here. So some of the chat that's coming through here. Oh, yeah, it was Hangerbird. I've been an Alyn subscriber for a while. Blah, 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 blah. James Baker, what if you have a bad back and can't then to look through that hole? Can't bend to look through that hole, right? It is quite a dip depending on how high you have this on your tripod. Yeah, you just go ahead and use the laser pointer method that we talked about last week. Just put that down there, and I'll pull this in a little bit so you can see it in the camera. But you just put that laser pointer right here, and you'll see where you're pointing at Polaris, and you won't have to bend at all for that. Shelly Diamond Star, we can go over the sky replacement in the course in the 22nd too. So she's going to talk about that sky replacement button in Photoshop that Alyn Wallace just mentioned in the live event on the 22nd. In fact, those uninitiated yet, here it is. This is Mary Beth's course that she's doing with me. It's a star-tracked Milky Way post-processing crash course where she teaches you Adobe Photoshop. Even if you're brand new to Adobe Photoshop, you can love it. If you watch no other video about it, watch this one that talks about all the things that are included in the course. And then our live day event, this January 22nd all day event, is going to be from 3 p.m. until 10 p.m. Mountain Time. So we're going later so that we can get Nick in there from the Australian time zone. He's over in Australia by Perth, so I want to make sure that he can come in and join us that time. So this one's going to be later. But when we do that live day event, you can join us, and it is on January 22nd. So hope that you will come. All right. So back to some of the chat messages. You know, it's interesting. Now, ever since I've changed this tech, the chat goes in and out like a quick pop on the graphic. That's too bad. Rakesh, not able to register for the workshop. Not able to because you can't come, or you tried and it wouldn't let you. Are you saying that there's a glitch? Hopefully there's not a glitch. If I go down here and try to register, click on the PayPal thing, the PayPal button will take me directly to PayPal, and that charge is going through no problem. So Rakesh, I'm not sure what your problem is. If you do have an issue with it when you're trying to go through the credit card payment option and it didn't let you go through, let me know, because I need to see what could be wrong, because everything looked golden to me before I put it up there. So let's work it out. I want you to be there, Rakesh. And Hangerbird says, I am a he, LOL. Awesome. Okay, man. So I'm glad that you're already an Alyn Walker subscriber. Thanks so much for watching that. Alyn is the man, Thomas Turner says. Yes, he is. And James Baker. And again, which one should you buy? Which one? Which one meaning which Star Tracker? Get the Skywatch Star Adventure and get it good for everything. If you're hiking a lot and you want to minimize weight, get the Move, Shoot, Move. That's really what it comes down to. Okay, so Rakesh says, it is just saying more info. So the link that I gave you down below for Crater Lake, it is letting you register. But if you go to my workshops, let me just show my Mac real quick while I solve that for Rakesh, because I really want him to join us. So iMac screen, taking you guys along on adventure. So say you go to photogadventures.com. And you click on the workshops. If you're seeing Rakesh, it still say more info, and you don't see these red sold out buttons, then you might need to do a hard refresh. Like on my Mac, I do Control R on, I think it's Shift F5 on a PC. Let's go Shift F5. That's going to be a hard one. So if you see this where it says bonus second instructor Alyn Wallace, then you know, Rakesh, that you have it. And join me and Alyn when you click on that button. It should take you right here. And then down at the bottom, or you can click on this button right here, reserve your spot now, and you should be able to go in. Click the PayPal, pay deposit only or full workshop price, or you can go right in and fill out your information. And so, oh, there's my address. Welcome to my place. And this is all working from my side, so you might just need a refresh, Rakesh. You might need to refresh. All right. Hey, Kirk, VM Nigo. Okay, Nasioi, whatever that nonsense was, I can't respond to it. Alan has a great channel, SS Mold. Thank you, thank you. And I missed something. Come on. Alan's HDR moon processing video on YouTube is mesmerizing. All right, I got to watch that. Jerry Thompson, I followed Alan for years, bought both of his brackets when they came out. Use the Star Adventure. Love it. Oh, thanks very much, as Rakesh. Well, thank you. I hope you join us. It'll be awesome to have you. And hey, Kathy, Steve, Kirk Kies is here. Kirk Kies is in the house. And so before I go into the final video of this live stream, ask me some questions. It is your last chance to ask some questions. We talk about the tracker. Just do it all caps text and ask me some questions. I'm going to show MaryBeth teach us how to do some post-processing with star trackers, because you're dealing with the fuzzy background as you're tracking the sky, and then you capture a second image of the foreground, you're going to have to be in Photoshop. And needing to be in Photoshop has completely opened up another challenge for you that maybe some of you have never done, where you go and actually use Photoshop for your edits. And so with MaryBeth's course, we're teaching you how to do that. And some of you might be wondering, is there anything really great to gain from this? I already know it really well. Maybe it's not for me. Well, I was talking about it earlier, and I also want to remind you that there is an option. If you don't want to join us for the live event, you don't want the extra hand holding, you can just get the online only option for 97, where it gives you all the online course content, it gives you image one and image two and the step-by-step PDF, and you can do that for more affordable price. But if you want to join us for all the hand holding, where I work with you individually one-on-one and you come to the live event and get image number three, then you're going to come for the full 197. So let's watch this video and go through it together. I want to help you guys know the Star Tracker post-processing. We've talked a lot about the gear of the Star Tracker. We've talked a lot about why you should get this little V bracket or Z bracket. And Alan helped us understand some of the things about polar alignment that never noticed that circle hole over there. These things are capture techniques, but the post-processing techniques are a challenge. So in this video, let's see, did I miss any all caps? Question, where's MaryBeth? Rumor has it she's in Salt Lake City. She is. She's in Utah, but she's not here today because I'm sick. I got the Oma cold right now, and so I don't want to get her sick. So she might hang out with me next week if I'm feeling better. But for now, she's not hanging out tonight during my live stream, sadly. And any other messages or chat questions coming through? All those fake images, LOL, from Shelby Diamond Star. Shelby Diamond Star is MaryBeth Kiczenski, by the way. And she's in Sandy right now. Awesome. I'm wondering, when you use the ZV brackets, do you re-level the horizon between track shots? That's what I missed. That's right. I saw that message earlier, Thomas. Okay. When you're doing a tracked shot and you're doing a panorama, you do not re-level it. All you have to do is go until there's the full motion of the clutch that goes to a certain point where you kind of have to reset it and then capture some more. Remember that the position of where your camera is in the rotation doesn't matter at all. The only thing that matters is that in the frame, you're showing everything you want. So let me paint that picture somehow. I'm going to paint that. I haven't gotten that part. I lost the step down screw in here that makes it so it fits that size. One moment. Okay. I got a box for a visual. This is my camera, and it's on a horizontal orientation right now, and I'm going to get everything in my frame. So let's say that everything in my frame is this Kleenex box. This Kleenex box is my subject, and now my camera is so rotated that it's taking pictures like this, and my Kleenex box is like that. We'll just say the Milky Way core is that section. So then I capture right here. Have I ruined my shot? No, not at all. Just because the camera is going to rotate with the sky still, and it keeps it here. But eventually, it gets to the point to where now it's angled so much that it's not showing the core, so I just reset up and get myself aligned well, where it's like, hey, now the Milky Way is back in my frame. I turn it on again, capture, and it rotates during that capture. So you'll constantly be re-leveling out as it does the full rotation. Okay, bring it back, okay? And then there's a full rotation. Let me take that out. That's not important right at that point. You will constantly have to re-level it over a long stretch of time, especially if you do like a stack of 10 or if you're doing a panorama. But if you are taking a single shot, you're not going to need to do that ever. It's during the panoramas that you have to do that the most. And so don't worry about where your camera is in that rotation as long as the subject is in frame. If you have a very wide angle and enough of your sky is being shown in the middle of the frame and you can crop around it, it'll stitch together the panorama, no problem. Learning from Eric Benedetti, panoramas are tackled from the left side of the core of the Milky Way band all the way to the right where the core is, because there's going to be movement in your core by the time you get to it. So it's best to do the left side first and then go over to the core. And during that time, he says he's had to readjust maybe twice to make it right, to work out pretty well. Depends on how long of a track shot as well. If you're doing 4 minutes per, then it's going to be sooner that you'll have to level out before the next one. So hopefully that makes sense. It makes a lot more sense in context, and it makes a lot more sense when you're sitting there in front of the tripod and you're seeing it go. We're not going to tackle that in this video, although I think maybe next week we should talk techniques, and I should borrow from some of Eric Benedetti's course where I can show you some of that content and let Eric Benedetti himself teach you that from the course. And so I think that's what I'll do. Next week on Milky Way Wednesday, we will talk the process of doing a panorama, as right now we're going into our panorama season and you don't want to miss it. So Steve says, at what focal length should you use the scope and Polaris offset rather than laser alignment? At what focal length? He was specifically mentioning that when he was out wide, he uses that just to basically see it. But you got to think of it this way. I always want a visual. I'll just ignore the visual. Hey, I got this. This will be perfect visual. Okay, so I'm looking through here, and I see that lens. Or if I look through here, and I'm trying to see the circle in Photog Adventures, right? All I'm doing is looking through this to see, okay, that circle's in there. Now that the circle's in there, I'm going to go inside the viewfinder here, this little eyepiece, and then I'm going to fine-tune it perfectly to it, because I know that there I got Polaris in that big circle. Now I can look down here and know that Polaris is in there, and which one is it? Okay, it's that one. Fine-tune. But at the same time, Steve, I would use the laser pointer, and you got it. So which focal length is going to be more forgiving? Wider focal lengths. The telephoto lens will be very, very picky. You wouldn't necessarily use... You wouldn't necessarily use that circle hole right there to get your polar alignment. That is kind of a quick step to go, okay, there's Polaris in there, so now double check. Oh yeah, Polaris is that star. Yep, Polaris is that star. That's just step one of two. It is not the all-encompassing only step, if that makes sense. And if I'm even answering your question correctly, honestly, Steve. And laser alignment. Okay, he also emphasized laser alignment versus using the polar scope, and I think it's safe to say that anything after 130, anything after 100 millimeters, you should use this if you're finding yourself losing connection. Like, at 200 millimeters, we still captured really nice for 2 minutes using just a laser alignment. We laser polar aligned, put on it for 2 minutes, and at 200 millimeter, it tracked. No problem. That can happen. Only when you see that you're losing it do you need to go, or you're going for 4 minutes and it loses it, do you want to go in and fine tune it with the perfect, polar alignment method that when you look in there, you find Polaris and put it at the right dot on that circle. All of that work. We can answer that more. I'm going to make a note of that while we're watching this video, that I'm going to answer that plus Eric Benedetti's technique for doing panoramas in next week's Milky Way Wednesday. Any other questions? Does putting on a Z bracket make it harder to balance everything? No, not at all. In fact, in all reality, it makes it so much easier. As far as balancing my gear on here, it's not really a balancing juggling act. It's really just tighten, and it all stays there. But when it comes to the clutch, I think you're meaning, like with the counterweight coming off the side and getting balance, there is more weight. And, you know, you might feel yourself trying to counter that weight by rotating back so the camera doesn't hang off of it. There's some reasons to get his move, shoot, move so that you can just take that, loosen it up, and then rotate this base. You can do that. But when it comes to balancing with the clutch, it's not that challenging. It's rarely a challenge that we run into. It takes a lot of gear and a lot of weight on top and a big old counterweight to start to have that problem. And that's going to be part of the video I show you next week with Eric Benedetti teaching it. So that'll help. That'll help next week for you, Hangerbird. All right. Anyone else? Awesome. Thanks, Aaron. Thank you. Yeah, wondering more about panos. Perfect. Well, he's ready for next week. Thomas is fixing the sky. You can also use Luminar. Okay, yeah, perfect. Shelby Diamond Star. Okay, awesome. Let's just go ahead into MaryBeth's segment teaching us how to separate a tree from the background using a technique that maybe you've never thought of using, something that's going to help you isolate a foreground subject from the sky and help create that mask that you're wanting to make.
So now what we're going to do first here is we're going to focus stack those two foreground shots. So to do that, you want to go to File, and then under Scripts, you want to put Load Files into Stack. And then you hit Browse.
And this is only because you have done the focus stacking you want to do
this way? Yeah, this is only for focus stacking. Like if you just had a foreground in a sky shot, you wouldn't need this step. So that's just for this. So then you click on your two or three or four, however many images you needed for focus stacking. You'll click on all of those and then hit open and you'll see them in here. And then I always click attempt to automatically align sources, because the camera actually moves a little bit when you, based on where the focus point is. So the computer here is going to automatically align those sources to the best of its ability.
Right.
Hit okay. And it's going to think about it for a second. And then it'll do. And there you go. So now you'll see you have your two images here. And it does a really good job aligning them. Like you can't even really see the difference there, like where the tree line is. And this one isn't too terribly complex. So this, the auto blend option should work pretty good with this shot. And that's where the Photoshop will take your focus stacked images and blend them together using an algorithm. And it works pretty darn well. There are other programs out there dedicated just for focus stacking, but I haven't had to really use them yet. So I just use Photoshop. So in order to do that, you want to hit your one image here and then hold down the shift key and grab your second one and then go up to File. And I think it's going to be, this is where I'm like, is it under edit? Yeah, it's under edit. Sorry. I mean, one of these days I'm getting all these tabs up top straight.
Well, the good news is they don't have to feel bad for not having these kind of steps memorized. You never will.
I never have it memorized. I'm the worst.
It's not required. That's
I just
good
know
news.
That they're there. They're up there on the top somewhere. So then you hit auto blend layers. And you'll have option here, because you can use this to make panoramas even, but I find other programs are better for panoramas, so I don't use it. But the option is stack image. Okay. And then always have your seamless tones and colors checked here too. And hit okay. And it's going to think about it again. And think about it and think about it.
And depending on your computer, it may think for a very long time or it may think for a short time.
This computer is pretty good. So like there, and you can kind of see what it did here. So you got a big mask right here, and then it does some weird stuff with the sky, but we're going to get rid of the sky anyway. And then if you zoom in, so the tree moved a little bit in this shot, but for demonstration purposes, it's okay.
Right.
But you can see that it blended in this foreground branches here that were out of focus on the other image. So that looks pretty good. And then sometimes if you have a lot of tree movement between shots, this won't work that well. And I'll show you, I mean, you can use masks too. So we'll do that real quick here. So I'm going to undo what I just did. So the other option for focus stacking, since really it's just the extreme foreground that was out of focus, which I think was on, yeah, right here. So you can use masking, and you can put a mask on it and erase it out on the bottom. So like right through here. Oh, I have this way down. And I had it on lighting for some reason. Okay. So then you can erase that back in down here. For this shot, that actually might just be better because of how this particular shot was. So those are the two ways to focus stack. And you'll want to, based on what your image is, one will work better than the other or vice versa. So I just wanted to give you both of those options.
Clarify those two versions real quick. Now that we've seen it, we may have been kind of glossed over a little bit. So just say again, like one way was using this method, one way was using that method.
Okay. So yeah, the first method, or I should say, this was technically the second method I went through, but the first method is, you know, you just add a mask to your top layer and then just mask out, you know, what's out of focus and let the other layer blend through. For this shot, that worked really well because it's just, you know, it really was just the branches in the foreground that needed it. So the second way to do it is under edit and then auto blend layers, which is grayed out right now because I'm on a layer with a mask on it. And the auto blend will take all of your images and then use an algorithm to blend them together the best that it knows how to do.
Okay.
That's really good for more complex shots, like the ones with flowers in particular, where you have all these little intricate details in the foreground. And a lot of times those shots are 5, 6, 7, 8 focus stacked images.
Right.
So auto blend works really well for that. For this particular shot, it's pretty simple. So I'm just going to roll with the masking to mask out the lower part.
Awesome.
So now we're going to flatten it, which is Command E for the shortcut. So this is going to be the master foreground shot. And we will, at this point, we will save it out as such. So we do File, Save As. And we'll let my unlimited creativity here go again. So this is going to be tree.
We're unleashing the creativity again.
What did I even call it? Tree.
Oh, tree, was it stack? Tree sample foreground?
Yeah. So tree sample, and we're going to call this the blend.
Tree sample blend.
So there we go. Now we have our master foreground shot ready to go. So this is where it gets fun and exciting because we got to take out the sky.
With all those leaves and this tiny space in between them.
Yeah, so this is kind of the original method to do it. And then I'll show you Topaz Mask AI, which I encourage everybody to at least try it. And then if you're a person that lives in an area where there's a lot of trees, you'll probably end up buying it. So the old way of doing this is just creating a mask, basically, with black and white to try to get as much of the tree branches as possible. So in order to do that, we are going to want to duplicate this layer. So you do layer, duplicate layer. And if you're an organized type, you would rename these. Or if you're just a hot mess like I am, you just leave them all. And then we are going to change this to black and white. So under adjustments, you'll see black and white. And then this little menu is going to pop up on the side here. And what we want to do is try to make as much as the foreground black and as much as the sky as white as possible. So you basically mess around with these color sliders. Just trying to see how far you can get it separated. And some images work better than others. This one actually might work pretty good. As you see, I took all the yellows out and you can see what it did.
Wow. It really
so we're already getting that separation pretty good here.
Yeah.
Because
basically you're seeing everything that is black is going to be taken out and masked away. So correct. you're seeing the leaves gone and all the roots in the lower half. You don't have as much detail in the bottom half to get rid of after this. It's already done the work for you. Awesome.
So that's what we're going for. So then you hit okay. And then to take it a step further, you want to go back to adjustments, and then you want to go to brightness and contrast, because we want to take this further. So you want to like really crank this stuff up. Now we're starting to lose some of the branches, so we're going to have to tone it back a little bit.
Okay.
But we're trying to get more of that separation. So like we see here, you got the sky way whiter than the foreground, which is what we're looking for. And then to make this mask even better, now you paint in the colors. So your you want all the stuff in the foreground black. So then you make sure all this is up high. So you want to go back in and try to paint. Oops, I went too far there. All this black as much as you can. And the same for the sky. So you want to kind of get rid of the grayscaling up here as much as you can, because that just helps the computer figure out what to grab. So just like this. And I'm just going to kind of make this sort of rough so we're not here forever. But it's the idea behind it. So after you get your mask roughed out here and you have your separation between the sky and the foreground, so now what we got to do is select the color. And this is why it becomes important to try to get that separation as good as possible. It just helps the computer pick up what you want to.
Well, whoops, I accidentally cut that off a little short, but it was actually really soon being over. I just turned off studio mode and I didn't click transition, and it went straight into thanks for watching. So we'll end it right there. Whoops. But Mary Beth's video is part of image 2 edit. And so she has image 1 edit and image 2. Both of those are on the online course content that you have access to forever. And then those of you who are part of the full hand-holding situation where you're part of that whole crash course, then you get image number 3 and the files for that in the live day event, as well as access to watch that replay of the live day event for life as well. So thank you, Mary Beth, in retro for giving us that lesson and helping us learn a little bit more about separating. If you're part of the Milky Way Photographers Guild, there was a video that Royce Baird did with us and taught us a way that he separated videos. And in fact, those of you who are paying attention will see this link I'm going to share with you now. And those who watch this as a replay later will think, oh, where was that link? Where was that link? I want him to give me that as well. It was a live and exclusive to Milky Way Photographers Guild video, but I am going to share it with you right now. And it was an awesome video where Royce Baer taught us one of his methods for selecting the sky, and it is yours to enjoy. And right there, Thomas says, I do something very similar in Photoshop. I use a luminosity masking plug, and I think it's TK. Yeah, TK Actions Panel, that's one I have. I have not used it in a long time. But thank you so much for joining me today. Thanks for hanging out with me and Alyn Wallace and Mary Beth Kiczenski. Next week on Wednesday, I will probably not be here. Mary Beth, we won't be here. I will be gone. I will probably jump in with some videos from where I'm at in southern Utah, hanging out doing some photography. But I will have a pre-recorded Milky Way Wednesday that will come out for you that night. And I mentioned that I'll be showing off Eric Benedetti's tips as well as some of his how to do panoramas, and using those clips in that pre-recorded video is a perfect timing for that, since I won't be here live hanging out with you. So thank you so much. Get out there and enjoy yourself an adventure of photography. Go out and see if you can capture. If you are not unlucky like the Peruvians who joined us today from Cusco, who are in the sorry raining season right now, and they will not have it clear until April. So if you're not suffering from a raining monsoon season and you have a clear sky, get out there with your camera and capture. Use your tracker. Make the use of Orion right now and make something happen. Really, really appreciate you guys all joining me tonight. Thank you, Dave. Thank you, everybody. And if you haven't already, come join us for more Milky Way adventures on the workshops. I have the last year of workshops that I'll be doing this year. Just check out the workshops link and join me. I will not be doing workshops in 2023. I'm taking a short break from workshops for a while as I focus on my book. All right. Thank you so much. The tracker processing class with Mary Beth Aaron is a good one. In fact, let me put that up there on the cam chat. So Steve's comment right there, he gives us a full endorsement that the tracker processing class is a good one. And thank you from Kaveh. Thank you from Thomas. Thank you from Dave, Amaki. Everyone have a have a good night and clear skies. Thank you, everybody. Have a good one, and I'll be back. Well, pre-recorded, we'll be back next Wednesday for another Milky Way Wednesday and throughout the rest of this year. I'm loving it. Appreciate you hanging with me tonight. I'm off to get some dinner. See ya.